Our guest today is one of the most revered voices in music. Paul Carrack is dubbed the man with the golden voice, and he wrote and sang How Long, the much-covered 1974 classic from his days with Ace, and was the voice of Tempted from his tenure with Squeeze. Then came such hits with Mike and the Mechanics, Silent Running, and the Grammy-nominated The Living Years and Over My Shoulder. But how many of you actually know the Eagles' hit song, Love Will Keep Us Alive, was co-written by Paul and won the ASCAP Award for Song of the Year in 1995. And he is also an in-demand collaborator. Paul's decades of distinction include sessions with the Smiths, Elton John, Roxy Music, B.B. King, and countless others, accumulating an invitation from Eric Clapton to join his touring band. So without further ado, let's welcome one of the most soulful voices in music history today, the man, the voice, the incomparable Paul Carrack. Welcome to the show.
Wow, what an introduction. Thank you.
Well, you are so welcome, but I'm interested, what sparked your interest in music growing up in Sheffield?
Oh, I think I was just fascinated by any kind of music, all kinds of music, you know. I think my father's family were quite musical, although we didn't have an awful lot of contact with them. But my dad encouraged the love of music. And I was interested in it wherever I could get it. I mean, it wasn't like wall-to-wall pop music like we have nowadays, obviously. But anything on the TV or something, whatever it might be, whether it be a classical or a pop or jazz or whatever. I love singing at school, hymns, things like that. Just a fascination. And on the pop music side of things, have an older brother, 4 years older. And he started getting into rock and roll and, you know, the Everly Brothers and things like that. The instrumental guitar groups, the Ventures, things like that. And then, of course, in my early, very early teens, or just before that, when the Beatles and the whole Merseybeat sound, then that really lit me up, actually. Yeah,
well, what was the first musical instrument you learned to play?
I'm still learning. Funnily enough, we didn't have much in the way of it. We lived in one room at the back of a store, a small store, which my mom ran the store. My dad, she sold wallpaper and paint. My dad was a painter and decorator. You know, you paint people's houses and stuff. We didn't have a lot of room, but we did have an attic up in the top where there were some bits of old drum kits. I can't call it a drum kit. There's a little bass drum. There's a snare drum. I think my dad used to dabble a little bit back in the day. So I would go up there and play on the drums to records, you know. But I was actually probably more interested in soccer than anything when I was a kid. I was outdoors all the time, all kinds of weather. But I did like music, and especially, as I say, when the beat thing happens with the beat groups, and we had a little band at school and we played the school concert and the girl screamed and that was it. I was done. That's me. I'll have that.
You know, that's funny because I've heard other recording artists tell me the exact same thing when they first had that real stage experience for the first time and saw the crowd or the girls go wild. They knew right then and there, that's what they wanted to do for a living. So was that for you, was it the same for you into where you're like, I want to do this is how I want to make my living. I want to play music.
It was quite early on because I didn't enjoy school. I wasn't very academic at all. No, in fact, I hated it. But so I didn't really have a whole lot of options in actual fact. My father had passed because he had an accident at work, and when I was 11, my brother kind of took over the store and they were holding the thing together. As long as I went to school every day, they didn't pay too much attention, but I knew I didn't have a career in anything else. Now, I grew up in Sheffield in the north of England. which is a very, at the time in the 60s, industrial city, steel city, engineering, coal mines, and work was almost like a religion, you know. And this staying at home and lying in bed in the morning and not going out to work was not considered a respectable way to carry on. But I'd already made my mind up. I just wanted to be in a band and be on the road.
Wow. Well, you mentioned early on that you liked singing hymns. Were you a church-going boy back then?
Not really. I mean, but we did have assembly most mornings when we would, you know, have hymns and prayers and readings. I was in the Cubs, and we were supposed to go to church once a month. But the church that we were affiliated with was this old, cold, huge thing, got kind of gothic, I suppose it was. It was an old school church, and it was cold, and there was a thundering great organ that, you know, would reverberate. And I think I had some sort of vertigo thing, because I hated being in tall buildings. And I was scared in this building. So if I could get out of going, I didn't go. No. Oh. Much to my dad's disappointment, because he was disappointed about that. He would have liked me to have gone.
Well, you know, and that's what parents do. But, you know, even when I was young, I mean, I didn't want to go either. So for different reasons, but I think it's a kid thing. But let's step up to 1974, because you wrote How Long? And while being the lead singer of Ace, are you surprised how that song has endured over the years?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, we were surprised that when it became a hit in the first place. I mean, we were optimistic. We were actually really just a bar band, you know, playing for having fun. We managed to get ourselves a contract with a very small label, made the record for nothing, you know. It was already in our set. We played it in our set, and it became slowly became a hit in the UK, and then to watch it actually go up the charts in the US was unreal, to be honest. We had no idea. We'd never been to America or anything like that. So that was all totally surprising and mind-boggling, but the fact, as you say, that it's still around now, still gets played on the radio, is unbelievable.
Well, you have recorded, well, I went back and listened to your extremely large music catalog, and I think there's at least three, if not four, versions of How Long that you recorded. There's one that has that big band feel. There's one with an orchestra. What made you want to cut different versions?
I don't know. Because the original's, you know, probably the best. It is a real record. You know, we were very naive. We didn't really know what we're doing in the studio. We weren't studio friendly. We didn't know much about it, but we captured a moment, and it definitely has a vibe, that record. Of course, you know, it was one of those terrible 70s stories. You know, we didn't make much money out of it or anything like that, so we won't go there. But I know, probably the first version I did, I always did it in on my gigs, you know, with whichever band I was in. And I think some point during the mid 90s, when I had a solo record contract with a small label, and they were quite keen for me to do another version of it. But I didn't try and copy the original. It's quite different, that version.
Yeah. And I've listened to all of the versions that you have done, and they all sound great. So what was the actual inspiration behind writing that song? Is there a story there?
Yeah, there's definitely a story. It's fairly well documented, but maybe not so much in the States. Because when we were starting out with Ace, as I said, we were playing for fun. It was bread and butter stuff. We're just playing in bars for fun. Some friends of ours were doing rather better with their band. They had a record contract. They had the support, tours, and things like that. And I forget the particular reason, but their bass player, I think he might have been ill, and they needed someone to dep for him for a few gigs. And they borrowed our bass player. I can see you're wondering, where's this going? So they borrowed our bass player, and to our disappointment, let's say, they were kind of keen to give him the job permanently. So I was very disappointed about that.
is that where the line, how long has this been going on, come from?
Yeah. Yeah. The friends with their fancy persuasions and all that. So, yeah. But thank goodness they did try and pinch our bass player. That's all I can say.
Yeah, because that song is extremely timeless. Now, I know that you played keyboards and supplied the backing vocals with Roxy Music from 78 to 81. It seemed like a very different departure for you going from Ace, and then as Roxy Music was kind of a cross between glam rock and punk. I mean, were you looking for a different music scene or a new inspiration?
It just happened. I mean, I wasn't particularly a fan of Roxy because they were the antithesis of what Ace were about. Ace were some scruffy plaid shirt wearing denim trousers, anti-glam, anti-show business. And Roxy were, of course, were the other extreme. They were very much, you know, into glam rock and all the rest of it in the beginning. So it was a bit funny that I ended up playing with them, but what it was, I knew quite a, when Ace had split and I was floundering around wondering what to do next, I started to play on sessions in around London. I wasn't very accomplished, by the way, so I always was a little bit insecure about doing these sessions, but I fell in with this crowd of guys who were my peers, who I thought, that's, you know, that's how you get to be better, as you play with these guys. And they had been playing on a Brian Ferry solo record. Roxy were about to go get back together and go on tour, but they were going to use these session guys on the stage. And they said to me, well, we know a guy. He can probably do this. So that's how I got involved with them. And I went on tour with them and I loved it. It was great. It was fun. You know, it was not taking itself too seriously, and Brian and everybody were great. I loved it.
Well, then, you know, 1980, when it rolled around, I mean, the music seemed to take on a different flavor than what we had in the 1970s. Then we had the beginnings of MTV, the British music invasion into the United States, a much bigger one than what we had with the Beatles and the Stones. But then, how would you describe the 1980s when it came to music for you?
Not great. I didn't like the emphasis on videos because I didn't really look the part. I'd never looked the part, you know. In fact, I look more the part now when I'm 70 than I did back then. But so the beginning of the 70s, the beginning of the 80s. Oh, yeah, it wasn't all doom and gloom. I mean, I had a stint with Squeeze. Actually, prior to that, I made a solo record that had one top 30 hit on it. It was called I Need You.
And right, on
it was on Epic. It's Bourbon, yeah. Voodoo.
Yeah, yeah.
The title of that album, yeah. So, yeah, the time with Squeeze was exciting because I loved them. I thought they had great songs, great energy. But I had joined when their keyboard player had left. I didn't even realize I was joining the band, to be honest with you. I'd made an album with them called East Side Story. And the next thing I knew, it was, well, we better go on, you know, we're going on tour. And so I had sung some lead vocals on the song Tempted as well from that album. So I think, you know, it was a bit...
Yeah, because you replaced Jules Holland, who left the band.
That's right.
And when the album was being produced, it was produced by Elvis Costello, correct?
Correct. That's right.
And why did he suggest that you sing the lead on Tempted?
Well, for whatever reason it was, I'm glad he did, because I think it's one of the best songs they've ever written. And I think it's a great, great song. I had joined literally a week or two before they started to record the album. In fact, as I said, I didn't even know I was joining the band. I thought I was just playing keyboards. So one day we'd more or less finished the album. And then one day we're kicking the song around, Tempted, which they had already recorded a completely different version. And then we started messing around, you know, with the organ and everything. And that's when Elvis came running in and said, wait, let's put this down, you know. And so we put down a track, you know, backing track. And then he said, oh, this is great. But you know what, Paul, you should sing it. And I wasn't going to argue with him. But so I sang, you know, most of the lead vocals on it. There's Glenn also sings on it. Elvis sings on it. And it became a little bit of a breakthrough hit for them in the States, which was, you know, a bit of a double-edged sword. A little bit, I'm the new guy, and I'm singing that song. They've already got two great singers. They don't really need another singer, and they don't really need a songwriter, especially not the kind of songs I wrote at that time, which was sort of, you know, lovey-dovey. They're more sort of new wave with edge and fantastic lyrics, Christopher. So it's a bit of a funny time. It was, as I said, I was a massive fan, though. I think they're incredibly talented.
Well, what was it like actually filming a music video?
I used to hate doing the videos. As I said, I didn't feel I looked the part. We weren't keen on that at all. But it was a necessary thing to do.
Well, you know, you being British and being heavily into the British music scene, kind of explain to all of us why being across the pond that America, in a way, and I've heard this from Canadians as well, getting a hit on the American music chart is like the Holy Grail. Why is that?
Well, it's the home of rock and roll, for a start. And it's a massive country. I mean, you know, it's so to be amongst that. For us, coming to America with, you know, with Ace, when we first came in 1975 to tour, it was just like going to the moon, really, because it was, you know, Britain was in a very austere place at the time. There were strikes, there were power outages, it was terrible. And we came to America and I think we landed in Miami, and, you know, we had hotels and as many towels as you wanted and a pina colada, you know, and all that sort of stuff. It was just, it's fantastic. Because, I mean, from leaving school and up until that time, I'd always been broke. I mean, completely broke. But we were living the dream, I suppose.
Yeah, and it gets addictive, doesn't it?
Indeed. Yeah, not that we became rich overnight, but at least we were amongst it, you know. And our first tour, we supported Yes, who were very established touring band at that time, playing arenas every night. And we were this, you know, ropey old British pub band in our T-shirts and jeans with no lighting and whatever. So it was a bit tough, but we got away with it just about with the skin of our teeth, because that was a big record on the radio.
Yes, it was also a very big video on MTV.
Yeah.
Yeah, very popular. Well, you know, right, like you.
But I was talking. I'm sorry. I was talking. I was talking about how long, mostly. You're talking about Tempted.
Yeah, Tempted. Well, yeah, and you know, it's funny because you're known for very particular songs, but I want to kind of step into your solo records, because we had just mentioned your second solo studio album was Suburban Voodoo, which was actually among Rolling Stone's top 20 albums of the year. When that happened, Did you think that you had it made as a solo artist?
Well, I thought I had a shot, you know. That album, it was produced by Nick Lowe, who was one of the reasons really that I'd left Squeeze. Other than the fact, as I say, they didn't need another singer, they didn't need another songwriter. So although I was in having fun being along for the ride, I knew at some point I had to, you know, challenge myself a little bit. Anyway, so I got involved. I wanted to be involved with Nick as well. I thought I was a big fan of Nick Lowe. So he produced that album for me. We had a little bit of a tickle with it, the single. But it's still, you know, that's just a foot in the door, you know, in a massive country like America, you probably need a bit more than that. Help me.
Well, your next album, the next solo album after that was One Good Reason, which I'm going to be completely honest with you, Paul, is literally one of my favorite albums of all time.
No.
Seriously, every song still sounds brand new today. Now, the big hit was Don't Shed a Tear, which was the big hit for you. But as I was researching the songs on the album, because I love listening to it, my favorite song on there is When You Walk Into the Room. And of course, I love Button Off My Shirt. But when you walk into the room, when you walk in the room, it has twice as many plays on Spotify, which, was that song ever released to radio?
Not in the US, I don't think. No. In fact, maybe not even in the UK. But funnily enough, Don't Shed a Tear wasn't a hit in the UK. No.
That's strange because I compared them, because on Spotify, it was at 5.5 million listens. And When You Walk Into the Room is at 11 million. So I was was it on the radio? But the song is fantastic. I actually dedicate it to my wife all the time.
Yeah, it's a great song. I mean, it's Jackie the Shannon wrote the song. I was familiar with it from The Searchers. I don't know, The Searchers, you know, The Searchers in a Liverpool band come up at the time of the Beatles.
No, I don't they think had, so.
Well, they had a lot of hits in the UK, mostly covers of American songs. Things like Needles and Pins, Walk in the Room was huge. But that album, funnily enough, I won't, it's not my favorite for different reasons, but I had been out of the picture since the Suburban Voodoo album. I'd been wading around, playing with Nick, doing endless bus tours, supporting people. But I basically got that contract to make a solo album on the strength of the Mike and the Mechanics first album. It was because that was, you know, very well received. Things like Silent Running, big radio thing. And somebody said, thought, well, we'll have another punt with Paul Carrack. They employed the same producer, record producer, Chris Neal, very good, successful pop producer. But that record to me is very of its time. It's very 80s. I suspect you're a bit of a fan of the 80s.
Well, I'm a big fan of the mid to late 70s. Mm. But I've been listening to more and more 80s because of so many people that I talk to. And of course, with, you know, the big year that Duran Duran had this year, you know, more and more people are listening to the 80s songs. And I think they're fantastic. But like I said, that album, there's just something about One Good Reason. I don't know what it is, but if I'm working in my office and I need something happy, that's the album I choose to play.
Well, that's Chris. Because he wanted the album to be upbeat and up tempo and all the rest of it. For me, it's quite programmed. It's very MIDI. orientated with all the sounds and everything. I hardly play on that album. I'm basically singing on it, and there's a little bit of Hammond here and there, but not much. So it's not one I refer to very often, because I think I've kind of gone back more to wanting to play rootsy music. You know, that's where I started out, really. And that's where I like to be nowadays, more, you know, rock and roll, soul music, that neck of the woods, rather than the kind of polished, quantized synth thing. But I had always wanted, at that time, I was quite happy to be in that place, because you asked me earlier about the early 80s. Well, and I was playing with Nick Lowe, and he was very anti anything like synthesizers, hated them, hated anything about that pop scene, and was completely swimming against the tide with this kind of rock and roll we were playing. We were playing a lot, we were touring, but we were never getting played on the radio. And I was listening to people like Paul Young, Simply Red, and all these people had a nice fusion with sort of blue-eyed soul and the synth pop sound. And I was thinking, I'd quite like to have a crack at something like that. And that's when I got the call from Mike Rutherford to get involved with Mike and the Mechanics. And I, you know, that was the beginning of that.
And you can hear the synthesizers across that album, especially with Silent Running and other songs. And really, the 1980s seemed to be defined by the synthesizer. But you bring up the Hammond. And, you know, the most famous Hammond of all is the B3, maybe a B3 with a Leslie.
I've noticed it
a lot in your videos or on your stage performances. You still play a Hammond. Which Hammond do you play?
Oh, I've got a few. I've got one in the corner there. It's a B3. I tour with a C3. When I play with Eric, he has his own B3. But it's all basically the same organ. The organ has hardly changed since it was invented. No, it's the same deal. It's the same exact structure and everything. It's a fabulous, fabulous instrument. Like I said, I'm self-taught. I just learned by listening to records. I wish that I had YouTube back then, because, you know, it's all on there now. But I used to have to listen and try and figure out, how is he doing that? And listening to people like Billy Preston and Jimmy Smith is pretty hard just to figure it out, you know, without any tuition whatsoever. But that's how I learned to play. And it is a fabulous instrument. And with a Hammond, you got all the colors that you need. You know, we do have synthesizers and all this, that, and the other, but it's all there on the Hammond, really. Well, and it's an organic,
And see, that's what I love. You know, as I'm hearing you, and I love people who are self-taught, and because I know with YouTube videos are very helpful for kids or adults trying to learn how to play an instrument and to get the basics down, I get that. But a lot of times it becomes very mechanical. People like you who learn by listening, trying to figure out, I think that's where a lot of the individual style is born and the emotion is born. I think a lot of today's music lacks actual emotion. This is why I love listening to your recordings and listening to you sing, because as we put it in the record business, you know how to sell a song, because when you sing it, we can feel the emotion of the words or the story that is being told.
Well, thank you. Thanks very much. I appreciate that. But I think, you know, in the recording process now, it may be changing, I don't know. But I mean, it is quite clinical in a lot of cases, you know, and you can edit and fix things to the nth degree. Whereas back in the day, when we recorded How Long, literally, we were just the guys in the room, and the red light comes on and you get a bit nervous and you're trying to capture a moment. And I think that maybe that has something to do with why the records of that time and, you know, have endured. And still, yeah, I mean, to me, my favorite music of all time is Motown. Definitely, because that's the great songs, great playing, great performances, energy, uplifting, fantastic.
Well, and see, that's what I love. See, I love watching music documentaries. You know, Sound Studio, Muscle Shoals, and I think that for a lot of today's artists who are so caught up in Pro Tools and everything being programmed, that they need to go to a studio that still uses tape and sit there and just produce an album the old style way, the old school way, because there's so much more emotion. If there's a mistake, sometimes that mistake becomes very iconic for that particular song.
That's so funny, because sometimes when we do things from Eric's back catalog, and even the Cream stuff or some of the blues kinds of stuff that he loves, and often we'll be emulating those mistakes, you know, and we'll be trying to work out what happens, and it'd be so difficult. It'd be much easier to just say, you know, what they meant to do was this, but we will try and what was going on there. It's so funny. Yeah. I don't know if it's necessary to go all the way back to tape. Although, again, with Eric, a couple of albums back, when he had Glyn Johns produce an album, it was done on 16-track tape. Yeah. But, I mean, it just takes so long for the thing to wind back. You know, that's the truth.
Yeah, I get that. I get that. And having to sit there and cut it at the right place and to put all that together, I get it. But I just love watching or hearing the stories of what they did back in the day before everything became very, very modernized. Yeah. But let me ask you this, because you know, like you were with Mike and the Mechanics, and yes, you know, everything really seemed to jump when Silent Running came out. Then there seemed to be a break, because he had to go back to Genesis.
Yeah.
And then y'all recorded the song Living Years. Mm-hmm. And are you surprised that song resonates with so many people? I mean, I even checked on Spotify. It's been listened to over 111 million times. There's just I guess there's a deep story there that we all can relate to.
Yeah. I wasn't really surprised. I thought it would be a big record. I think it has a powerful sentiment. I mean, the song's written by B.A. Robertson and Mike. I sang it. I always wanted to sing that song, because in the original Mike and the Mechanics, there were two of us that took the lead vocals, myself and a guy called Paul Young, not to be confused with the other Paul Young. This guy was a guy from Manchester, sadly no longer with us, passed away in 2000. But we would often, when initially we were both there as singers, we weren't involved in the writing, and Mike would write with the BA and Chris Neal, and then they would think, now who's going to sing this? And they would often have us kind of audition, if in a way. And Paul was a great singer. He was also we were very different personalities. He was very outgoing. He was the rock and roll guy. He loved all that. I was a bit more sort of reserved and, you know, sincere or whatever you want to call it. But I knew when I heard the very first take of that song, I need to sing that one. I mean, because I don't want to go dwell on it or go on about it, but I lost my dad when I was 11 years old, and it's definitely a very, very profound experience that, you know, affected my whole life, no doubt about it. So I don't want to get, I don't sound like Prince Harry here, but it's the truth. And although the song is definitely not identical about my relationship with my dad, which was great. I loved the guy. He's fantastic. Only knew him for 11 years and he had this effect on me my whole life. But, you know, I just felt that I could bring what was needed to the song. Whereas I think Paul, for all his great singing, his great voice and all the rest of it, it wasn't the kind of song he would want to get into. Do you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean. Yeah, because yeah. I lost my father back in 99. So when I listen to The Living Years, I'm like, you know, there's parts of it that I can completely relate to. And I know millions of people relate to that song the exact same way. And what a monster hit that became, Grammy nominated. But then you got to co-write Over My Shoulder with Mike. How did you end up finally getting to co-write with him?
I don't know. He just opened it up a little more, because in the beginning, it was really Mike's project. You know, it wasn't a band, to be honest, in the first instance. It was Mike's project, but he gave it a band name, which was a smart move on his part, I think. And the guys that he got in were guys used to playing in bands, you know, and used to making things work and working as a team. And it was good, because it was a good opportunity for us. Mike was in one of the biggest bands in the world, if not the biggest. And but Phil's career had gone ballistic. So Mike, you know, he had a bit of time on his hands, put this project together, wrote some songs, got a couple of singers in. And then that started doing pretty well. Also, I mean, Living Years was a number one record in the States and a lot of places. So where was I going with this? Where did we start with this?
Well, you co-wrote Over My Shoulder with Mike.
So I think Mike wanted to involve us more, and I just started to get together with him and write songs, and that one came about very, very quickly.
It became a big hit.
Well, I don't know if it was a hit in the States, but it was definitely a hit in Europe and the UK. I mean, I performed that one myself. I still perform The Living Years and Over My Shoulder in my own set, and I think that's fair enough. I'm not in Mike and the Mechanics anymore, but there is another version of that out now. But I think I'm entitled to sing those songs, to be honest.
Yes, you are, because you have that, like I said, you have that very unique and distinct voice. And in a way, you're very blessed to have, you know, these very particular songs from different decades to sing, that I'm sure some people in the audience go, oh my gosh, he's the one that sings that song, you know, and to bring in new fans. And, you know, yeah, your voice is, I would have to agree with the BBC documentary. Yeah. The man with the golden voice. I agree with that wholeheartedly. But I want to kind of talk a little bit with you and Nick Lowe, because you wrote quite a few songs together, one being Battlefield, which was recorded by Diana Ross. What was it like to have a legend like that put one of your songs on her album?
It was amazing. But the story of the song really is Nick wrote the song really for me, for an album I did called Groove Approved. And I can remember now him calling me up. I was in a hotel room in the US, and we cut the track and we needed the lyric, and he just dictated the lyric over the phone. And I thought, yeah, that's a good lyric. That's a brilliant. But I think at the time I was grumbling a lot of the time. I was moaning and whinging because I was singing songs and making people, helping people with people's brand, and they were making money from that. And I'm thinking, well, a lot of it is down to the vocal and maybe phrasing and, or changing a little thing here or there that stuck, you know, that becomes a part of the song. And Nick very graciously gave me a piece of that song. I felt better about it when Diana Ross recorded it, because she was being produced at the time by, please edit this bit out, because I there shouldn't be a pause. I should know. Peter Asher. Sorry.
That's
sorry,
all
Peter,
right.
if you ever watch this. So Peter Asher, and he called me up one day and he said, we love that Battlefield. We're going to record it. Do you think it needs a middle bit? It needs a middle eight. And I said, I'll call Nick now. And we got together and I think I had a hand in the middle eight of the Diana Ross version.
Well, there's nothing like mailbox money.
Nothing like it. No. Right.
Well, what shocked me about your music legacy was that you were actually a co-writer on the Eagles hit Love Will Keep Us Alive. You co-wrote it with Jim Capaldi and Peter Vail. It wins an ASCAP award for being the most played song in the U.S. in 1995. So kind of give us the quick story on how the Eagles got a hold of that song.
The quick story. Am I waffling on? I think I'm waffling on.
No, not at all. Take your time. No rush here.
Okay. Well, so if you remember in the mid-90s, the Eagles had kind of split up for whatever reason. I'm not privy to it. But I got a call from Don Felder, the guitar player in the Eagles at the time. And he said that he, Timothy Schmidt, and possibly Joe Walsh were looking to work. They were frustrated. They wanted to work. They wanted to do some recording and do some shows. I didn't know Don, but I knew Timothy. I knew Timothy B. Schmidt from the days of How Long, when we first came to the States.
Yeah, from Poco.
From Poco. And that's when I met Timothy. Anyway, Don called me up and said, do you want to come over and see if we can make anything happen? I went over there and did some songwriting with them. And on one of these trips, I took a song written, as you say, I think the title came from Jim. Jim Capaldi had this title. Peter had the top line and the kind of shape. And then we got together and we put the lyric together and the thing, and I sang the demo. And I took it over to this project that we were doing in Malibu. And everybody loved it. And I was singing it. And Hervé's off was getting excited and interested in this thing happening and coming to fruition. We were recording songs at Don's studio. And okay, I'll cut it a bit brief now, because I guess to cut the long story short, the Eagles did get back together.
Yeah, because Timothy actually called you because they needed another song on the album, and he wanted to use that song.
That's right. That's right. That's well. I mean, I just thought that was the end of that. It was a shame. It would have been it was a nice thing to do, but I totally understood, obviously. But then I got the call from Timothy saying, how about, you know, we need a song for me to sing. And we were thinking Love Will Keep Us Alive. Said, absolutely. Fantastic.
Yeah. And now so it's been great. Sung at every Eagles concert since then.
Has it really? Yeah. Great. Well, don't tell me how many million streams that has had.
Well, I want to ask you, about your songwriting process. I mean, is there a particular way you like to go in to tackle a song, or just an idea pop in your head?
No, that I don't know how I do it myself, actually, which is why I dread when people call me up and say, oh, we're doing this songwriting seminar and we want to show the kids how to write songs. I don't know how it's done, you know. It's a different process when you write with other people, I guess. But I think some of the better songs I've written personally are the ones I've written myself, but I don't know quite how it happens. It can happen, just by jamming in here, you know, and this is my little studio. I jam in here and get a little nugget of an idea and then expand it and add some instruments and build it up and put some, is that going to harm? Yeah, that'll work. My songs are pretty simple.
Well, you have a brand new album about to debut called Don't Wait Too Long. Has a very big band sound, very soulful. I believe that it debuts January 20th. So, ladies and gentlemen, get ready for that. Is there a particular theme behind all the new songs?
Not really. It's, to be honest, here I go again. Stop me if I've never spoken so much in my life. But I met these guys, a big band, a very good big band, won all kinds of Grammys. They're based in Stuttgart in Germany. And about 10 years ago, they asked me to, would I be interested in singing a Christmas album with them, the usual suspects, you know, in the swing band style. I went over, did it. I loved it. And it, each year since then, I've done bits and pieces, concerts, few recordings. And it's usually been in that sort of Sinatra neck of the woods. I don't try and do a Frank, but I try and do my version. But we said, well, maybe we should, how would it be to make an album, just rein it in a little bit, the repertoire, make it a little bit more from my roots, and a little bit of Ray Charles, a bit of Bobby Bland, you know, even Etta James, and go for a kind of a vintage sounding record like that. And it's fantastic. So that's how it came about.
Well, you're right. It's a very vintage sound. And you've had albums to where you've done quite a few covers of artists that are in the, you know, the R&B and the soul and the blues. And you just have, it's kind of like on the new album. You have one of the singles that you released called Trust in Me. And there's something about, I love listening to that song because of the fact that, again, like I said before, you bring out the emotion through your music. We can hear you sell the song. Like I said before, you sell the song. We feel it. It grabs us deeply. We can sing along to it. That's what one of the other things I love about a lot of your songs is, because to me, what makes a hit song is if the listener or the fan can immediately pick up on it pretty quickly and sing along with it. And then it's stuck with them. You know, Trust in Me is one of those songs. I literally can sit here and hear your voice singing it right now. And
well, great. Of course, the original, or the, at least where I know it from, is by Etta James. And let's face it, she absolutely nailed it. You know, it's great. But I love it. I love the song. And I'm not precious about covering stuff and, oh no, you can't go there. It's, you know, I'm doing my version. It's not going to be Etta. She killed it. But I love singing good songs. So, and like I say, with this album, it is a bit different for me with the big band and all that and the strings and everything. But whether it's stylistically your cup of tea or not, well, it may or may not be. But I actually think my vocals on this are as good as anything I've done. You know, I honestly think that.
Yeah, I believe that. And your voice, to me, you know, I can go way back to Ace and hear you sing How Long. Then I can hear you sing How Long Today. And then all of your current songs, your voice has stood the test of time. And a lot of singers can't say that, but you can.
Well, it's holding up pretty good. I'm not complaining. I mean, I take pretty good care of myself. I'm not a monk, but I don't drink any hard liquor or anything like that. I like a glass of wine. I don't smoke. I try and stay healthy. And if I stay healthy, it seems to be okay. Again, I'm not trained, but I've learned a few tricks from YouTube. Warming up, it's important. All that kind of stuff. I don't take liberties. I've never been a screamer or a shouter. I often wish I could. I'd love to have a little Richard scream, you know, but I don't. I mean, it's always kind of smoothish. So, but I don't know. I am 71, but I like to think that in many ways it's getting better. I'm a bit more economical with the high stuff, and the register down low is getting better. But singing is a weird one. It's a blessing and a curse, because when it's all there and it's happening, it's great. It's lovely. I mean, I can go to a lot of places I want to go to, you know, with the phrasing and everything like that. But, you know, it's a struggle, because you've got to be healthy. You've got to be strong. You can't be under the weather. But you, mind you, you find ways through. And that's all part of the learning process, I guess, you know, how to get out of them corners and all the rest of it. But it's a constant worry when you're on tour and stuff like that, you know.
Probably more in this day and age due to what has happened in the last 2 years. And with lockdowns, no touring. Of course, a lot of people have been recording like crazy, trading Dropbox files back and forth to get songs ready for albums when the lockdowns were over. But for you, what does touring look like in 2023?
Busy again. Busy. Like this year, last year was very busy. I have my own band. I have been working with Eric. You know, I don't take that for granted. That he can change his mind at any point, but I'm going to Japan and America with him this year. You know, but going back to, you know, the lockdown thing, in a way, that was the thing I didn't miss at all, was worrying about getting sick. You know, I was at home, I was working in my studio, that kept my mind busy and active. And I thought, well, if I get a cold or if I get sick now, I haven't got to do a show, you know. So.
Well, there's always a blessing in disguise there, that's for sure. And ladies and gentlemen, Paul Carrack, I mean, you've heard it from the beginning into the brand new album about to be released. By the time you see this, it is out. Don't wait too long. His brand new album, Soulful, Swing, Big Band. You're going to love every song on this album. And again, for me, Trust in Me and the title cut, Don't Wait Too Long, are amazing songs. And for all of you who are fans of Paul Carrack, you need to go, our new fans, go to paulcarrack.net for all of his music, his touring schedule, and you got to get tickets to Eric Clapton's upcoming tour, as Paul will be part of the band playing keyboards and that Hammond B3 organ. So, Paul, man, it's been an absolute honor and a pleasure today to have you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I hope I haven't been waffling on too long. One thing I just want to say before we go is that we should, of course, give a mention to Madeline Peru, the songwriter of the song Don't Wait Too Long. I don't think we mentioned her earlier, but it's a great song. I'm a big fan, and I'm glad we remembered to give her a mention.
Well, you know what? That shows how genuine and honest and just a perfect gentleman you are to remember the songwriters of these classic songs. Man, it's great to know you, Paul.
Well, thank you, man. Thanks for getting in touch. I'm honored. I mean, like I say, I've concentrated a lot on the UK and around Europe, because I've been doing things independently and we've built up a nice thing here. It's difficult to make it a thing like that happen in the States on a small scale. But I just love coming to the States. I always have done. It's the home of rock and roll. And I'm glad I can still get there with Eric and what have you. And here I go again. I'm talking. What's going on?
Hey, that's great. I mean, because I know that Eric has a residency in Japan coming up in the spring. And then y'all be touring America. So hopefully I will get tickets to that incredible show and to see all of you.
Great.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Paul Carrack, the man behind the golden voice. You know the songs, How Long, Tempted, The Living Years, but you have to check out all of his solo albums. If you're not a fan now, you're going to be a fan very, very shortly. And don't forget about his brand new album, Don't Wait Too Long. Just a huge collection of songs. You're going to love it. Big band, swing, soulful. And you know how we love that soulful type sound here on the Ward Bond Show. And again, Paul, many blessings to you and yours in 2023.
Thank you, sir, and the same to you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, stay tuned. We'll be right back with more.